Good morning and welcome to TPC Live. I'm Pastor John, and we are so glad that you're here with us this morning. Wherever you are, maybe you're here locally in Orange County or scattered throughout the United States or extended throughout the world, we're glad that you invited us into your life, into your faith life, into your family life. We have a wonderful service planned this morning, a service of hope, a service of healing, and a service to remind us of Christ's redemption in our lives. Good morning.
Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Here we go.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. To order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Hey, this is amazing. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, oh, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
You would take my place.
That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, oh, oh. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Ooh, 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 ooh.
thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Well, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, and I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, and you know just what we need before we say.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
And you are
perfect in all of your ways.
You are
perfect in all of your ways.
Thank you, worship band, for leading us so well this morning. Matthew and Jessica Holtorf is with us this morning. She has been on assignment in Denver leading a neonatal care unit. Is that correct?
Yes.
How are we doing?
Sounds good.
Leanne Rosine, our family ministries director, is with
us
as well. Good morning. So it's great to have Jessica with us and Megan and the whole band. It's great. So thank you for leading us in worship. Hey, friends. Whether you're new to us or you've been viewing and been a participant of our congregation for many years, we're so glad that you've tuned in this morning. There are lots of things happening in the life of our congregation, and I want to just highlight a few. You received a letter from me this week giving us an insight about how we will regather and how we're going to approach that in our regathering. Now, we want to be together. I want to regather. Looking forward to that. But we need to make sure we do it correctly with guidance for the health and safety of our congregation and our community. In the letter, I invited you to join us as this has become a mission initiative of this congregation, a way that we're going to continue to reach out, not only here locally, but also globally through our live stream service. Many of you have shared with us about how important this live stream service is to you and how it has helped you connect with not only your church community, but a larger community throughout the United States and throughout the world. So we're going to continue this service, and yet it creates some unique challenges for us that we're ready to take on and we need to take on. And so I've invited you to participate in this. We want to be giving together so that we can gather together, dear friends, in a safe way. So please read that letter and be in prayer about how you might participate. We're estimating it's going to cost us around $40,000 to be able to do both live stream and have concurrent worship services here in the sanctuary, but also in other locations on our campus. So friends, join me. Join me in prayer and join me in giving as your session has led us so well to this point. What else have we got going on?
Well, speaking of connecting, you have the opportunity to connect to our new website. Check it out. You will be able to put your email if you'd like to receive updates every week with our beacon. You'll be able to offer prayer requests. You'll also be able to learn about our small groups and our Bible studies and the life and ministry of TPC that is happening now and continues. And also, wanted to let you know that we are in the final stages of our pictorial church directory. Thank you, Kim Krasko. So if you have not already submitted a family pic and you would like to, please email kim@trabucopress.com as soon as possible. In a few moments, we are going to be invited to read the Apostles' Creed with the Vanderwall family. But we wanted to also invite you to celebrate the newest member of their family, Jacqueline Ray, who was born on April 21st.
Hello, we are the Vanderwall family. I'm Sarah. This is Jackie and Evie, Eric, Matthew, and baby Jackie Ray. Join us as we confess our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I'm going to say amen.
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 Thank you so much, Vanderwall family, for leading us in how we confess our faith. We hear God's voice in a variety of ways, dear friends, as we confess our faith together in community. We also hear God's voice through scripture and through prayer. And this morning, we have a special guest who's going to lead us in prayer, Gary Pato, who has been a finance elder here at our church, but also is currently helping us in our preschool project. And so I am so thankful for Gary and his family. Three graduates this year in your household. And so you're a busy guy.
Pretty busy.
Okay. Well, Gary, thank you for being here to pray with us.
Thank you, Pastor John. Today's reading is from the second book of Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 11 through 14. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All God's people here send their greetings. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In this time of pandemic, economic uncertainty, and protests against social injustice, please pray with me. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all for whom we are called to be stewards, saying, God of all goodness, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for our world, which you made and renewed in the power of Jesus' resurrection. We pray for policies and laws that regard our home in God's universe as a precious gift. For our families, our household, and our communities, that your life together, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may show us the like importance of each of us, and so strengthen us in your grace and truth. For the sick and those who suffer in any way, for those who struggle to pay rent or a mortgage, for those who have no home, for those who are neglected and abused in our communities, for people who long for family and are instead alone, for children who do not have a good guide to raise them up, and for whatever else you see that we need. Into your hands we entrust all that is of concern this day, sure that you hear our pleas, grateful that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this in the name of the Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. For the homeless and all those who stray, come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your
mentioned during the announcement time that we are taking communion this morning together. So if you would like to get some bread, a cracker, and some juice ready for later in the service, we will commune together. Who can forget that at the beginning of the stay-at-home orders, that our stores started to run out of important resources. Chief among them was toilet paper, right? And paper towels and hand sanitizers, all these things that we needed. And all of a sudden, they became scarce. Store managers and suppliers would just simply say, we've come to the end of our resources. I was talking to a mother this week, full-time job as a realtor, and she has three children, and they're all in school. And towards the end of the conversation, she said, John, I've come to the end of my resources with this school thing. Like many of us, business owners, employees, managers, there's certain points that we've just come to the end of our resources during this time. Who hasn't felt that they have come to the end of their resources in life? A disappointing letter, a sharp criticism, a loss of a job, a financial reversal, a relationship ends. Your health takes a turn. We come to the end of our resources. On top of a pandemic, our society is now disoriented in the ugliness of racism. It's reared its sickening head, causing social unrest on a scale that we haven't seen for years. The murder of George Floyd opened up deep wounds, wounds that have never healed, revealing a systematic crisis, a crisis of injustice. And the cries of injustice are loud and clear. Black Lives Matter protests joined by people of all races and colors and ages and cultures standing together with one voice demanding change. People have come to the end of their resources, standing side by side. And what started out as peaceful in many cases, some turned violent. Civic leaders and police officers, and they're all trying to figure out how best to maintain order and allow for public protest. In some cases, they've come to the end of their resources. End of our resources. You know, I participated in several marches and protests this last week. One here in RSM, I stood with our neighbors, our families, young and old alike. We joined together in one voice, hoping for change. But I'll be honest with you, there were times that as I walked away from that moment, it was helpful, it was healing to be together with others, of course. But I walked away with more questions than answers. I've been a part of several listening groups with other leaders and pastors on Zoom, and we listen to one another, we pray, seek reconciliation. What can we do? Full disclosure, friends, I've sat through these and been more disoriented towards the end, a little more discouraged. You know, we hope, but they start out with anger, of course, and complaining and blaming, and frustration sets in. Turns out who did what and who's not doing what they're supposed to do. Just more questions. Likewise, I've been holding this tension. I wondered how to come to terms with my faith and the deep distress that I feel from the injustice of our friends, neighbors, and what they're going through. So what did I do? Well, I set out and I prayed. I confess my prayers seemed shallow. I decided to write out my feelings, bare my soul on paper, but the pages were empty of any solution or remedy. My obligation to you is to be saturated in God's Word. I trust that I hear God's voice through His Word, through the Scriptures. So that's what I did. I started with the church's prayer book, the Psalms. You know, we know for certain that the Psalms was Jesus' prayer book, a place that He went to. He was raised reading the Psalms and praying the Psalms. His mother Mary would require that he memorize the Psalms, as all Jewish boys were required to. It's a place that Jesus often turned to. It's the number one book in the Hebrew Bible that Jesus quotes from. When he's frustrated, when he's come to the end of his resources, filled with brokenness, temptation, and uncertainty. Reading the Psalms this week, I once again became aware how personal these prayers are. Almost all of them are in the form of poetry. They're written by people of all different walks of life, both peasants and kings, some very accomplished musicians, and others are written by those who couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, which I associate with very well. And yet, they are all prayers. And each prayer comes from a place of shifting emotions between gratitude and sorrow, thankfulness and despair, sadness and hope. Friends, the Psalms are a resource for the church, a resource for you and me in times of difficulty, because they're examples of ordinary people struggling earnestly to make sense of what they believe about God and what they are experiencing in their everyday reality. In the Psalms, you'll find that there's Psalms of thanksgiving and Psalms of praise, as well as Psalms of lament. Did you know that the Psalms of lament outnumber the Psalms of praise and gratitude? 70% of the Psalms are Psalms of lament, people crying out because they have come to the end of their resources. Here are some examples. Psalm 74. Have regard for your covenant. Have regard for your promise, God. For the dark places of the land are full of haunts of violence. Do not let the downtrodden be put to shame. Rise up, O God. Psalm 55, listen to my prayer, O God. Do not ignore my plea. Hear and answer me. My thoughts trouble me, and I am distraught. I see nothing but violence and strife in the city. Contemporary prayers. I'm poured out like water. This is from Psalm 22. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It's melted within my chest. My strength is dried up. My tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me down in the dust of death. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from the words of my groaning. Sound familiar? Biblical scholar Walter Brueggemann, he explains the Psalms are an assurance to us that when we pray, that when we worship, we're not expected to censor or deny the deepness of our own pilgrimage. Life is dislocated. No cover-up is necessary. The Psalms are honest laments of people in desperate edge of their lives, on the edge of their faith, at the end of their resources. Christian author Kathleen Norris, in her book, A Cloister Walk, she claims that the Psalms are a mirror in our world, but they do not allow us to become bystanders, change the channel, to move on. Rather, the Psalms force us to recognize our part in it. They make us re-examine ourselves. You see, when we join in the prayers of the Psalms, our voices lament what we believe ought to be changed and where we need to change. Like Job, the psalmist clung to the hope and the belief that God is ultimately good. God is loving. God cares. God cares about all people. All people matter to God, no matter how things appear in the present. Holding on to the hope, the Psalms cry out for justice. They lamented that God's will was not being done on earth as it is in heaven. As a result, the prayers have helped God's people for centuries to regain and to realign their life with their daily experience. How? Well, prayers of lament are filled with a deep sorrow. That is true. They speak the truth, but each one is woven in with a balance of steadfast hope. Psalm 56, when I am afraid, I will trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I will not be afraid. Psalm 62, my soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from Him. He alone is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. I will never be shaken. Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget His benefits. He who forgives your iniquity, who heals, who redeems, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. This week, I stood with others, neighbors and friends, in our community, civic leaders, here in RSM, we gathered around a city hall. And during this protest, several stood up and spoke aloud and shared their thoughts, their hearts, their souls. A young African American woman stood up and she shared her lament, bearing her soul with the heavy burden that she carries on her heart, for the injustice, for what she has seen, the loss of life, the brokenness. We stood in silence, saddened by the stories of racism that she has experienced. And yet, in her story, she shared how thankful she was for the police officers that helped her when she was a child. You see, she explained, and she didn't go into great detail, but her mom was unfit to raise a child. And there was an occasion when police officers came and rescued her and brought her to safety. She's ultimately adopted, and she grew up here in our neighborhood with a wonderful family, provided a home and safety and healthy relationships. And as she shared, she became overjoyed with gratitude for her family, for her parents, but also for the men and women in blue who saved her life. You see, prayers of lament carry sorrow and gratitude. They're honest with ourselves and honest with God, honest with the trouble and yet the times of difficulty and pain, but also where our steadfast hope truly lies. Honest, where our hope comes from. Where does our hope come from? Dear friends, we heard it earlier in the scripture that was read by our friend Gary Pato. The Apostle Paul writes, the love, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, that is our source of hope. That is where we come for our ultimate resource to sustain our faith in the times of difficulty, in times of lament, when we hurt, we carry the burden of those in our society. Dear friends, we've come to commune together this morning, a resource that Jesus provided for his disciples as they gathered together in the upper room, as he took the common elements to remind them of his love and what he will ultimately do on their behalf to restore and to redeem. And so at the end of the meal, they gathered together.
And Jesus took the bread. And after giving thanks, he broke the bread. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat of it, remember me."
And in the same way, at the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup, the cup of the new covenant. A new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus looked around the room to his friends, his disciples. He said, "Whenever you drink this cup of forgiveness, whenever you drink this, remember me." Dear friends, whenever we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup, we together proclaim the birth and the life and the death of our risen Lord until he comes again.
Amen. Would you pray with me? God, thank you so much for this meal. This meal that nourishes us, that strengthens us, and God, that reminds us of your amazing love. God, I pray that by your Spirit, we would be united as your followers, offering all that we are to you, all that we have, our offerings, Lord, that they will be used to glorify you and in word and deed bring hope and healing to this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
So in listening to Pastor John's sermon, I was reminded of a song from my youth, not just my youth, but many of us as believers, our youth. So we didn't practice this, but if just real simply we could sing this together, that would be great.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, all are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, all are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
There's nothing better than you.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
I'm not afraid to show you. Call me friend, 'cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley.
Amen.
There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Better than you.
again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for us. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. Yes, you can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only. Better than you, oh, there's nothing better than you, or oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Dear friends, go out into the world with peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Help those who suffer. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God bless you. Amen.